So the plan for today, so I told you lecture one was dark matter exists. It was sort of a descriptive laundry list of evidence that there's dark matter. We should take it seriously. Lecture two was one and a half or two of the leading candidates for dark matter and the story, the narrative behind them. And this lecture is about, so lecture two, we got to calculate some quantities. This lecture is more about how we search for dark matter. And there's been more activity on WIMPs, so I'm going to focus on WIMPs. I'm just going to do WIMPs today. So it's going to be a bit more descriptive again, because what I would like to do is to give you a little bit of a flavor for the types of searches that we do, and how one goes about doing theory work that is related to these searches. So that's the idea. So the paradigm is that there is some interaction. Let me, this is going to be sort of one of these famous plots, so let's put it more in the middle. Some interaction between two dark matter particles and two standard model fields. And this may or may not be the interaction of the WIMP that gives us the thermal relic. Again, we alluded in maybe even the first lecture, no, probably the second, that even if we have asymmetric dark matter, in many models we need this interaction also, and it would be even stronger than the interaction you would need for a WIMP, because you need to take the symmetric bit and annihilate it away. So this is well motivated both for thermal, both for some non-thermal models such as asymmetric, and in general, if we have a new particle in the theory, an interaction like this could exist. And now, how do we? So we're this, they're that, and we want to search. So you can draw arrows of time. I'm sure you've seen this. So this sort of thing appears in dark matter talks all the time. You can go this way, which is what we did yesterday, and annihilate two dark matter particles into standard model particles, and stand here and observe. You can do this, which if I can right on the side reasonably well. It means dark matter is coming in, a standard model particle is coming in, and you scatter, and you kick a standard model particle ever so slightly. Or you can take this side and do it in reverse, in which case you're producing dark matter. And that you can do every time you have enough energy, which is probably at a collider. But maybe even a fixed target experiment if dark matter is light enough. Let's see. We've done all possible directions. This direction is equivalent to that one by time reversal. So yes, we've done all possible things. So this is called direct detection for some reason. I've heard people complain that this is more direct than that, but this is called indirect detection. It has something to do with the fact that this is happening on a tabletop in our lab, and this is happening very far away, even though I'll give you a funny counterexample. So this is direct, indirect, and collider searches for dark matter. And so the plan is to talk some about each of these. I happen to have worked on all these things at some point, as some of you have as well. And randomly, I decided to start with this, direct detection. Okay, so let's start by, we need a clean slate. Direct detection, so this is a very famous and very heroic effort. Does anybody know who first proposed the concept of a direct detection experiment? Who were famous person? Okay, Goodman and Witten, same Witten. That's one of the first direct detection papers I'm aware of. But details have been worked out by Katie Fries and Drew Keir later on, and this goes back to the 80s. And the idea is that you take a very sensitive detector, go to the bottom of a mine, which is a terrible place to be, but experimentalists, Tobias is not here, not that Tobias, the other one. Good. So experimentalists are amazing. They're willing to go to the depth of the earth to search for anything. And you sit and wait and look and you build the awesomest detector that you can. So what are some of the important things you need to know about a direct detection experiment? And there are many of them, and I'll list a few. So one of the first things you need to know, let's not number these, let's just bullet them, is what is the detector made of? What is the target material? Is it, so typically which element in the periodic table are we talking about? In particular, it matters if it is heavy or light. And that changes kinematics. Is it heavier than the dark matter that we're hoping to find, or is it lighter than the dark matter that you're hoping to find? Does it carry spin? Some elements some elements have actually a large dipole moment, a large spin that could couple to dark matter in a spin-dependent way, and others are spinless. And wouldn't couple to dark matter if dark matter chooses to couple to spin. So that is one important thing. The second important thing is what is the detection method? And initially, for many years, the theory community didn't really care about this question. All you needed to know is that some brave experimentalist built an awesome detector, and they produced for you a plot with the dark matter mass on one side and a cross section of scattering with a nucleus, or with a nucleon, really. On the other axis, and that's an input. That's something I can calculate in a model, and then I'm done. And in the late 90s and throughout the decade of the 2000s, detection. I can't spell if nobody noticed. In that era, people all of a sudden realized that dark matter can couple in all sorts of funny ways, in which makes this question very important. So let's see how this plays out. So what things could a detector in principle look for? Well, there's what did I put up top? There's charge. So dark matter can come along, hit an atom, dislodge some electrons in the process. This maybe not only the atom that was struck, but the neighbors as well. And then if you put this in an electric field, the charge is collected somewhere at the side of the detector. So that is one thing you can look for: charge that was dislodged from atoms. You can also look for heat, or vibrations of, say, a lattice crystal, phonons, just nuclei searching. And you can also look for light. So in this process of electrons being dislodged, light can be emitted. So some materials emit scintillation light. That's what this light is. Many soft photons that can be collected using photomultipliers or something of the sort. So you can look for any of these three. Sometimes it's really good to look for more than one, right? You can, all of these can happen in the same collision of dark matter. So let's give some examples. So there's actually a triangle here. Apparently, I don't know of an experiment that looked for all three simultaneously. That's really hard, and that would obviously be the best thing to do. Just measure the hell out of everything. But you need to pick your battles. So let's talk about some examples. So here we have xenon experiments. So xenon is both the name of the element that the experiment is made of and the name of a collaboration. And there's another collaboration called Lux, which is essentially the same technology in different people on a different continent. So these are these experiments look for both for charge and for light. Essentially, it's a huge. So now let me take this and turn it into a detector. It's no longer the sigma M plane, and it's this big vessel of liquid xenon. And what happens is that dark matter comes along, it strikes a xenon nucleus. The xenon nucleus emits some light, which is collected using photomultiplier tubes. And the electrons are drifted upwards so you get two signals, and there's a time delay between them. So using this delay, using the pattern of light that you see, you can also localize the event to some degree. And that allows you to, say, veto the ends, because backgrounds come from the sides. So maybe you want to look at a fiducial volume in the middle. That is an important strategy that these experiments use. So this is a liquid xenon detector. And another reason that experiments want to use both, you measure more than one thing, is that if you measure more than one thing, so usually you can take an event and make it a point in a plane. So you measure two things, signal one and signal two. I didn't make this notation up. This is what xenon uses for their two signals. This is light and this is charge. And every event is a point on this on some plane. And they always use their own funny units, because they have to work hard to extract this. So we need to cut them some slack. So sometimes it's hard to convert the units on these axes to energies, but it's on us to learn their language. And it turns out that oftentimes background events will fall into funny bands on these plane, on this plane, and signal events, which will be red, so though a signal event doesn't tell you that it's a signal event by being red, right? So you can discriminate signals from background better if you have more than one variable. So in this particular case, you measure most of the energy using this axis, but signal to background separation is done using this axis. So that's xenon and lux. The background, by the way, can be gamma rays. Yes?
So will you also detect neutrinos this
way? We'll get to neutrinos. The answer is yes, but not yet. I'll talk a little bit about neutrinos. Excellent. So that's lux and xenon. We need to populate this diagram here. Okay, so another famous experiment that collects both charge, the amount of charge, and heat and phonons is the CDMS sort of pipeline of experiments. So this is xenon. CDMS is made out of germanium, but they also have silicon. So these are semiconductor materials. Again, you can excite some electrons across some band gap and collect them using little electrodes at the side of the detector. But you can also pick up vibrations of the solid lattice. It used to be CDMS, now it's super CDMS, and it's moving to a deeper site in snowmass, Snow Lab in Canada. Very good. CDMS was, maybe one instance had sort of an anomaly. One of their silicon-based analyses, silicon is lighter than germanium, had three events with a background, expected background, I believe it was less than one. So we all got excited for a little while. And then in subsequent analyses, this was shown to just be a fluctuation. This happens, but it triggers us thinking. Okay, there's also an experiment called CREST. I believe it's in Gran Sasso, which is made out of calcium tungstate, I believe. So it contains tungsten, which is the heaviest element that I'm going to put on this board. And it measures these two. CREST also had some anomaly at some point, which I think went away when they replaced some of the clamps holding their detector with less radioactive material. These experiments are, it's very easy to contaminate your detector and see something. And then there are the brave experiments that despite they say, okay, I don't care about measuring two things. I'm going to measure just one thing. And yes, maybe I'll have a background and I'll do something else about it. There's an experiment called Cogent, also famously had an excess at low energy, which turned out to be background. And there's an experiment called DOMIC. Both of these are Chicago-based. DOMIC is made of CCDs like in your phones. So it's silicon. I asked Juan Estrada, who is one of the people at Fermilab and is on DOMIC, whether we should be collecting our phones and contributing it to DOMIC, and it turns out no, our phones are way too dirty. So they look for short little tracks. This experiment, when I show you some limits, this experiment specializes in light dark matter. CDMS is also starting to specialize in light dark matter. Okay, that's. Am I forgetting anybody? I feel like I am. Oh yes, how can I forget? Oh yes. DAMA. So DAMA is an experiment that only collects light. It's just a big scintillator. And they get a lot of background, and they're proud of it. And they say, we are going to look for the modulation. So the story with modulation is that we are going around the center of the galaxy. And as we're doing so, we're also going around the sun. So we're doing this sort of helix motion. So sometimes our motion is into the wind, and sometimes it's out of the wind, if you want. So our relative velocity to dark matter is modulating annually. And DAMA, for the last God knows how many years, at least 13, has been seeing a statistically significant modulation signal. I'll show you where that signal is and how it's actually ruled out by almost all of these other experiments. And so one of the model building challenges for a while, and still is how do you reconcile a positive signal here, maybe also the positive signal here, but that went away, with everything else. I would say this field has slowed down a little bit, mostly because maybe we just ran out. For a while, there were many ideas. They all died. So we maybe just ran out of ideas, and then it's the best thing I can do to resolve DAMA is tell young people about it, so they can. So your integrated brain power is better than all of ours. And also the DAMA collaboration, they've been a bit stubborn about not sharing their information. So that's another reason people may have shied away from it. But this is an open question. One more technology. There are bubble chambers. So there's an experiment. So I would put these here. But I'm not sure it should be here. It's an experiment called PICO, or used to be KU. Another, I think this is a collaboration between Chicago and Spain, of all places. And this is just a bubble chamber, so they measure heat that dark matter dissolves in a super-cooled, deposits in a super-cooled liquid. But they do something else in addition to measuring the existence of this bubble that is formed in a liquid. They also listen to the impact. And it turns out that background sounds different than signal, if you put a microphone on top of your detector. So I'm not sure whether sound should be another thing here. So this is sort of the technology. So this is a very diverse, took me a while to tell you about it. It's a very diverse set of experiments looking for the teeniest, tiniest signals. Okay, so that's one other. So the detection method is important. So why is it important? So for example, let's say I come up with. Here's the first example of why detection method would be important. Let's say we come up with a model of leptophilic dark matter that only likes to talk to electrons. Okay. That means it wouldn't be, when it comes in, it won't necessarily be kicking a nucleus. Maybe it would only be kicking out an electron. So maybe these experiments that collect charge would find that dark matter. But if you're only looking for heat, there's not a lot of heat in the event, right? There will be some light, though. So I would say these experiments would be sensitive. However, xenon would call this event background, because it's something that produces a lot of charge. Well, it produces charge and light in the proportion that their background seems to produce. So I guess the question is, for xenon, are you giving, and same for CDMS, are you giving your energy to the in the electromagnetic sector first, in which case it looks what they call background, looks like some gamma ray that came in, or are you giving your energy to a nucleus directly? So just by saying dark matter interacts only with electrons immediately tells us that this is important, right? This the way in which you detect dark matter will tell us something about it. Okay, questions about these detectors? I didn't build any of them. I built a cloud chamber once, but there was no signals of dark matter in it. It was for my children's science fair project in school. It was lots of fun. I recommend it.
What's the volume of the silicon detectors?
Oh, they come in pucks like this, but yay big. I believe in CDMS there were a couple dozen of them stacked together. So and stacking them is a good idea, because you want to veto any event where there was more than one hit in more than one detector at the same time. You always look for single hits. You always veto surface events. So they come in various sizes. And I can tell you why that matters a bit later, maybe. Dama is yay big. Xenon these days is even bigger. Right. Damic is measured in the grams, so it's the diversity in sizes and volume, mass, and material is very large. Thanks. Good question. Okay. Yes. Why xenon? Why xenon? It's it didn't have to be xenon. I think it's a combination of so a noble gas that is pretty inert is useful for this, that can live in the liquid phase is good. There is a proposal. Is it called X-mass? I forget the name of the experiment. I apologize to the experiment that is proposing to use liquid argon instead. There's even a more ambitious thought to use liquid helium. Dan McKinsey from Yale, no, he moved to Berkeley, is looking at that. So my guess is I'm pretty sure it has something to do with how much liquid xenon costs versus how much liquid argon costs. But yeah.
I think it has to do with the radioactivity. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, so they have whole factories of, they buy their xenon from somewhere and then they filter it to death. And so a liquid is good for that. You can keep on filtering your detector and cleaning it. And I think neutrino-less double beta decay is also being looked for using xenon. I think EXO. Is it EXO? Yes, EXO is a xenon detector. Good. What else is important for direct detection? Well, there is... So once you decided how you're looking for it, then there's the question of what it is, what is it that you see? What's the sort of plot with a bump on it that you can make? These sorts of plots are a bit hard to digest. What theorists tend to produce, if you want to do phenomenology for these sorts of detectors, is some energy spectrum. So usually, the quantity that we like to calculate is the recoil energy. Dark matter will typically give you a recoil energy that looks like this. Let's see, how does this come about? So let's think a little bit about the kinematics of dark matter is coming in. It has some momentum, p chi. That momentum is just the dark matter mass times the velocity, which, so in this part of the talk, all velocities are 10 to the minus 3. Okay? It's just easier to write v than 10 to the minus 3. Right? So the energy is mv squared. It's 10 to the minus 3 lower than that. So just for your, so if you have 100 GeV dark matter, that means 100 MeV of momentum, 100 kV of energy. Good. And now this dark matter is coming in, and it's hitting a nucleus. And let's say it's changing its direction by an order 1. So if you wanted to think about the maximal amount of momentum or energy you'd be giving the nucleus, then maybe recoiling completely backward. But changing your velocity order 1 also means that delta p, the amount of momentum exchanged in the process, or q, is also of order this thing. Okay. And now, what is the... Now, I'm this sector. I'm not that. I cannot measure this momentum change, unfortunately, since I'm not made of dark matter. But the recoil, this recoil energy, the thing that I want to calculate the spectrum for, is just going to be, well, I started in, if I'm in the lab frame, I started off with momentum 0. Now I have momentum delta p. So the energy is delta p squared over the nuclear mass. So the mass of my target is obviously important. It's harder to kick something heavy. So let's replace it with... So you see, the velocity enters the recoil energy. You can... Now, detectors are difficult to build, and you always try to build the detector that is the most sensitive that you can, but there will always be some threshold energy, right? Some energy below which your detector just doesn't register anything, or that you don't trust it, or maybe there is background. So it's convenient to invert this and then do it more carefully and define the minimal velocity that you need in order to produce a recoil of a certain type. Now, so let me write down the first term in this. Mu everywhere is the reduced mass. So that's just the mass of the dark matter times the mass of the nucleus over the sum. So that's the effective mass in the center of mass frame, as often shows up in physics. Great. So you see that if you want, let's see. Do I want to see this? Uh, Right, so mu is, well, usually it's dominated either by the dark matter mass or by the nuclear mass, right? And it's turns out to be the smaller of the two. So mu, the simple way to remember it is that mu for the hydrogen atom is the electron mass and not the proton mass. So here, if dark matter, if the nucleus is very light, this is dominated by the nuclear mass, right? Other way around. If dark matter is light, then this is very then this is the dark matter mass. So this is a large ratio. So for a given recoil energy, I need a large V min. So if the velocity of dark matter, so this is often called F of V, this is the distribution of the velocities of dark matter. It has some Gaussian peak and an exponential tail. Obviously, if V min is here, I'll pick up more signal. If V min is here, I'll pick up less signal. So for dark matter, light dark matter equals high of V min, and therefore less signal. So immediately we see that it's going to be hard to look for light dark matter. Let's see, let's take another, now I need more room here. Okay, let me remove this. This is something that teachers do to annoy students. I apologize. Let's introduce something else into the problem. Let's introduce the possibility that this particle was chi, and this particle is chi prime. This is known as inelastic dark matter. And the mass of, so now all these formulae will be incorrect, so I can remove them. The mass of chi prime is going to be the mass of chi plus a little bit. And delta is always a good name for something small. So that can completely change the kinematics of the story. In particular, if delta is sufficiently large, this just is kinematically inaccessible, right? So now I'm legislating, by the way, that the interaction is chi prime, standard model. And this is much larger and dominates over the one that just has a chi here, the elastic case. So let's introduce the possibility of an inelastic splitting between these two. And if you work out the kinematics carefully, this just adds another term to your minimal velocity. So a completely different framework for dark matter direct detection was invented, called inelastic dark matter, IDM. This was during the iPhone revolution, actually preceded the iPhone revolution. So Neil Weiner and Dave Tucker Smith are visionaries for calling it this, and maybe Apple picked it up from them. But IDM was one of the first models that really changed direct detection phenomenology. One important, so let's assume that this term dominates over this one. So so I can pick delta such that this is subdominant. If I want I always want a smaller V min, right? A smaller vmin I can get by increasing, counterintuitively, increasing the mass of my nucleus. Right, for this term, if I increase the mass of the nucleus, I get a larger vmin, which is bad, which makes sense. I have, if I'm trying to detect a ping pong ball by measuring the recoil of a bowling ball, that would be very hard. But here, I prefer the bowling ball. The way to think about it is that, let's think in the rest frame of dark matter. Dark matter is now sitting there, and a nucleus is coming in, and the goal is to excite the dark matter to a higher level. Right? So now you want to give it more energy and more momentum. So for inelastic dark matter, heavy nuclei win. Why is this important? I didn't tell you what Dhamma was made of. At the time, so Dhamma is made of sodium and iodine, a very light element and a very heavy element. CDMS, at the time that Dhamma came out and when IDM was first proposed, CDMS was the biggest, maybe the only experiment in town other than Dhamma, and it was ruling Dhamma out significantly. So these guys said, well, maybe inelastic dark matter is happening, and I wouldn't know it if I wasn't in the direct detection business, but iodine is much heavier than germanium. Okay, and so maybe germanium is not heavy enough to excite dark matter to a higher level, but iodine is. And that is why Dhamma is seeing a signal and germanium is not. So that's an interesting observation. Now, since then, what happened? All these other experiments turn on. Xenon is right next to iodine on the, very close to iodine. I don't know right next. My knowledge of the periodic table is mostly from this business. Xenon is close to iodine, probably heavier. Tungsten, oh boy, that's very heavy. So these guys could easily, if Dhamma can, they too can excite dark matter. And so that idea eventually died. Questions about inelastic dark matter? I can tell you more about it. But before that, I will tell you how this formula is actually computed. Time. Ooh, okay. I'd better hurry up. Yes, every quarter of an hour. So the number of events in a direct detection experiment, so the differential distribution with respect to this recoil energy, so this is going to be just this plot. Well, it's going to be something like, well, always rates go like n sigma v, right? Ish. Now, here I want to take the d by d recoil energy of it. Let's do this more precisely. I have the number density of nuclei. There's an m in here for normalization. You can ignore that. Now there's an integral because there's a whole distribution of velocities of dark matter between V min, which is a function of the recoil energy. So that is the V min that we calculated here. Up to, well, in principle, infinity. Well, infinity. There's no velocity of infinity. There's velocity of one. But up to a Vmax, which is taken usually to be the escape velocity of our galaxy, which is a few hundred, it's around between 500 and 700 kilometers per second for our galaxy. Again, our virial velocity is around 200, so it's a factor of a few higher. You integrate over velocities. There's the v from the n sigma v, so I'd better not forget it. I'm integrating over this distribution here. And this, so this part is cosmology, many body simulations of dark matter and what they tell us about the velocity distributions. So this is pretty poorly known, but we have all sorts of guesses for it. And this is particle physics. So this is the cosmo part of it. And this is the thing that again brings dark matter close to home. So again, this is mad-graphable in principle. So that's HEP. Excellent. And again, this is just a fancy way of writing n sigma v and integrating over the appropriate things. A common choice for, yes? Okay. A common choice for f of v is something Gaussian-ish. So if f of v is so this is a typical choice for this distribution. You plug this in. And let me just tell you what the answer is. So obviously, like in Tillman's lecture, in this story, the exponents are always the most important thing. So just because of this story, because of this exponential decay here, you get an exponentially falling spectrum, which is, again, not surprising. Dark matter is generally slow. And you need some energy to excite a nucleus. Just for completeness sake, this energy up here, E naught, is twice mu squared v squared over the mass of the nucleus. So this behaves in the way that you think. So experimentalists are faced with the daunting challenge, especially if dark matter is light and the nucleus is heavy, of which is what you get here, yes, of detecting an exponentially falling spectrum with a detector that often has a threshold. Good, so that brings me to the limits. Say that again?
Why is, you know, it would be Gaussian? Like this.
So this is a good fit to what comes out of simulations.
But isn't it in the input of proper simulations?
So say that again more slowly, yes.
Is it simulation? This comes from simulating.
That is the most reliable input. I think in the olden days people just guessed this. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that this was a reasonable guess according to simulations, but so direct detection limits always look like this. So I didn't tell you what the axes are. Again, on a log-log plot, this is the cross section. I alluded to this earlier. This is the cross section. So here, so we've done all of this. We understand that there is an exponent here in the light dark matter region, and that means that at some light dark matter, and this depends from detector to detector what the recoil threshold is, there will be some exponential crapping out of your limit. Now, for high masses, this will just go down linearly. Do we know why that is? Why is this crapping out linearly? Unitarity, no. Flux suppression, yeah. So if dark matter is heavier, what the number we're keeping fixed is the energy density. So the number density goes down, and n sigma v is proportional to n. So that's just that effect. Currently, lux is the world's best limit as of, what do you mean, no?
The preliminary results from Panda X.
Panda X, whoa! When did this happen?
2 days ago.
Look, I'm preparing lectures and they release it while I'm preparing lectures. Sorry, Panda X is how much better than lux?
A little smaller.
Ah, come on, okay. So lux, a week ago, and I thought it was like being hip and cool, and I know that lux maybe a week ago updated their limits. Panda X, by the way, is a the Chinese version of lux and xenon. Okay, so it's not a new technology. Thanks, Gopi, for correcting me, though. So lux slash Panda X are the world's best for the bulk of the distribution. This so the crapping out here happens at 10 to a few GeV, and the best limit is around 33, thank you, a few dozens of GeV. Here, this axis, again, is measured in ridiculous units. So 10 to the, I'm going to guess 10 to the minus 46 without even looking at what they actually said in centimeters squared. Let's put, okay, it's meaningless to put just one number here. Let's put 10 to the minus 39 here, and then you can, in your mind's eye, add all the appropriate number of ticks here. The reason to put this in is that some experiments are beating lux at low masses because they have a lower threshold, so that would be Domic and CDMS is sort of cutting a chunk here, unless somebody's put out results in the last few days that I'm not aware of. Anything? Okay, great. So this is sort of the state of the art. Any more about direct detection? Questions about direct detection? I think, one more thing I should tell you. Spin dependent and independent. I'll tell you in words. Dark matter can interact just with matter in a spin independent way. So namely, it interacts with spin up and spin down with equal sign. It could also interact with a spin, independent means same sign for up and down. Could be spin dependent, which would be a plus sign in the interaction for up and a minus sign for down. Now if you have a nucleus that interacts with dark matter of the latter type, and it has a spin up and a spin down sitting closely together, dark matter cannot resolve the distance, the momentum exchange cannot resolve this small distance, right? So there will be just simply destructive interference between spin up and spin down. So what that means is that you will lose coherence between all the nuclei in the nucleus if you are spin dependent. So these are the spin independent limit. They are stronger. And what you need to know is that spin dependent limits are about roughly an A squared, where A is the atomic number of the nucleus in question. So that's a big suppression. So all these limits just go up. They are A squared worse. Okay, so that's important. Yes? Neutrinos. Ah, yes. Thank you. Oh, good. So because I misplaced one of my pages here, thank you. You're replacing my notes. There are a few other things on this plot. There is something called the neutrino floor, which I will add in a different color. Oh, the yellow is good for neutrinos, because often it is yellow. And it looks something like that. This funny feature. Now, you may look at this and think that this is like the coasts of Africa and South America. They mesh together in an interesting way.
Is it a log-log plot?
Yes, this is the same log-log plot.
So it cannot be. Should be absolute value. Wouldn't show up.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. So there's no zero. I just ran out of space. So I'm continuing the axis. Yes, this is not zero. Okay, don't worry about it. The fact that these sort of line up, that this goes up when this craps out, is just a coincidence. In fact, this is coming from solar neutrinos. So solar neutrinos can strike a nucleus and make it recoil in very much the same way that dark matter does. So this is an irreducible background, and here it's atmospheric neutrinos. Very good. So the solar flux simply, the solar flux, if you Google the images, it looks like this cascade of things, and it eventually is exponentially turned off at, is it an MeV, neutrino people? Federon? Yes, okay. So that's boronate, so that's sitting here. So someday, at some point, direct detection people will turn into neutrino physicists. And do interesting solar neutrino physics. But in the meantime, we still have an opportunity to look for dark matter. Or maybe we'll invent a detector that is sensitive to direction. And then we can at least veto this part, just look by stuff that's not coming from the sun. Okay, a few more things to tie up to Tillman's lecture. If I have a pure Higgsino dark matter, so it's just pure Higgsino. It's for the most part a Dirac particle. It's a doublet, so it interacts through a Z. Where would that be on this plot? And the answer is somewhere up here, above this. So just a doublet Dirac dark matter, which is what you would think, like a weakly interacting massive particle. What's more weakly interacting than just a doublet? That has been ruled out way, way, way before all of our time. Higgs-mediated interaction, so if you have some sort of, say, Higgsino-Beno mixing going on, and Higgs, like Tillman showed you today, is the thing that is mediating the interaction, that lives, interestingly, around here. Now, MSSM plots, if you do scans of MSSM, it looks like this sort of funny amoeba shape, But those features come from the assumptions that were made in that fit. But generally, it's around the place that we're looking at right now. If you had pure Wino is a triplet. So it turns out you take the neutral component of the triplet, it can only interact by exchanging two W's with the nucleus in a loop interaction. Turns out there are two diagrams, one that involves a Higgs that ties to the nucleus to the two W's, and one without the Higgs, just a box diagram. And these two destructively interfere. At some point, the field got the sign wrong, but that was fixed. It's destructive. So that, unfortunately, lives mostly underneath. So this is a doublet, just a pure double. No, sorry, this is Higgs exchange. The doublet was up here. And this is the triplet. Okay, so now I've told you, I think, everything I planned to tell you about direct detection, and I'm way behind on time. So I need to make an executive decision. Yes, oh, sorry. Model dependent. So certainly these ellipses that I put on here are model dependents because they have models attached to them. They are model dependent in the way that, so for example, if there's inelastic dark matter, this simply does not apply. So Dhamma used to sit like somewhere in here. If you got interactions from the iodine, if the interactions was on the sodium, it lived up here. Also ruled out by now. So yes, almost all limits in physics are model dependent. Anybody who's telling you otherwise is cheating. So inelastic dark matter is sort of one very concrete example, and there are others, momentum dependent. So there's an order one fraction of the list that I'm going to leave here for your enjoyment is people inventing models to make this plot not apply and adding some other axis to it where things change drastically along it. Yes?
But shouldn't the neutrino detectors be able to also detect
the dark matter? Neutrino detectors, as you stereotypically think of them, typically have thresholds that are way too high. So the thresholds that, so Dhamma, the Dhamma signal was around 3 kV. The threshold of Borexino, let's just throw the name of an experiment that's nearby Dhamma and is also sensitive to electron recoil, is about a factor of 100 bigger than that, I believe. Yes. So neutrino experiment, because neutrinos have a higher energy, they're relativistic. The kinematics is very different, and you can get away with a much higher threshold.
Yeah, but if dark matter is light also.
But it's cold. Neutrinos are relativistic. And that changes the kinematics. I invite you to look at that. That said, some people, including some people in the room, namely me, have written papers about the fact that, well, maybe there's new physics in the neutrino sector and I can raise the neutrino floor and get direct detection signals. So that is certainly a possibility, but that's new physics. It's not dark matter, but it's new physics. Okay. So, hard choices. Indirect detection or colliders? Show of hands, indirect detection. Colliders. Ooh, close. I think indirect detection won. But I'll try and tell you, give you some thoughts on both. So indirect detection is a very different story. You stare out into empty space. Well, it's not empty, it has dark matter in it. And you look for dark matter annihilating. Even here I should pick some. So let me give you a little bit of the lay of the land of what are the relevant observations and the relevant experiment. So we need to pick three things. You need to pick an instrument. And you can do it, again, in no particular order. You want to pick a final state that you're annihilating into. Including the what energy. And you want to pick a region in the sky. That you want to be looking at. Okay, so here are some of the possibilities. So if you're looking for, let's say the final state you are considering are E plus and E minus. So some detectors cannot tell the difference between E plus and E minus, so that's why you look for this total flux. This can be, for example, Fermi, the Fermi satellite. But also, I think Hess is a Cherenkov array that can measure this to some degree. And if you're looking at this final state, before I do that, you can also just look for E pluses. There are many more electrons than positrons in the universe. We're here after all. So there will be more background in electrons than positrons. So if you can tell the difference between the two, maybe there's less background. Now, dark matter will produce both electrons and positrons. So maybe positrons is the thing to look for. Turns out that the thing that is more convenient to look for is this ratio. And then Pamela or AMS are the experiments in question. Once you've made these choices, the region of the sky has already been determined for you, because even if dark matter is annihilating at the center of the galaxy, so if it's in the center of the galaxy and we are here, the electrons and positrons will take a path that is approximately like this, or like that. And so you expect signals coming from these guys to be isotropic. Famously, there is an excess in this ratio that was discovered by Pamela and its predecessor and successors, and confirmed by AMS. So this has an excess, which I will not draw for you. Above a few GeV. Now, there's a big warning sign here. The question is, this is an excess above what? What is the background? And this field doesn't have the luxury of something like Pythia that LHC people have. The question of exactly how does an electron or positron propagate from anywhere in the galaxy to us is a very difficult question, and there is not a lot of input to it. So all of cosmic ray and astroparticle physics is input, but that is not enough information to really pin this down in a way that is necessarily completely robust. So there are codes. There are attempts to do this. The Pythia of this field is something called Galprop. This is a royal pain in the butt to run and interpret, at least I think. There are simpler options. So Marco Cirelli, for example, I'm probably not spelling his name correctly. But Marco has put out a sort of shortcut cheat way of doing this. I think it's even in a Mathematica format. It's called the recipe book for indirect detection. So that is something that you may want to be aware of. But I have friends that simply think that this whole approach to cosmic ray propagation is just complete BS, and this excess is Stater Mal physics. So if you want to hear a mouthful of it, ask Fear Bloom, a professor in Weizmann, what he thinks about Galprop. You'll enjoy it. So that's something we need to contend with. Now there, you can, instead of looking at this, you say, ah, well, let's look at photons. Okay. So for photons, you need to tell me what energy of photons. And then there's Hess and CTA, which is future. This is present, this is future. And this is for energies that are certainly greater than 100 GeV and into the few TeV. There is, again, the Fermi satellite, which is energies, say, above, let's be kind, 0.1 GeV to a TeV, where they run out of statistics. And then you can go further down in energy, integral, looked in the MeV range. X-ray satellites, there's an excess at 3.5 keV that some people work on. So that's interesting. So how do you calculate the flux that one of these instruments sees? So now I don't have this problem anymore. I pick some region in the sky. Let's say it's a dwarf galaxy. So I'm sitting out here. This is the galactic center. I'm looking at some region in the sky where I know is dominated by dark matter. And I want to calculate the flux that my instrument will see. So here's the simple formula. So the flux, which is a function of energy, an angle, opening angle, solid angle. This has units of number per time, also per GeV and per area and per solid angle. So it's a very lots of pers in the units here. So this is an integral over solid angle. This is the integral of along the line of sight, dl, of just the dark matter density along this path. And again, this is so this is going to be so this, well, you know, again, everything in cosmology is n sigma v, really hiding all rates, but in this case it's n squared sigma v, because what we're really calculating is a rate per volume, and you need two dark matter particles to meet. So this is the n squared. And, well, there's the cross-section. Oh, I've already paid this m squared. And there's this quantity, which is the number of photons. This is the number of photons per annihilation. So this is something that is just, this is just a spectrum that, again, you can calculate using your favorite high-energy physics tool. And again, this is just a cross-section. So again, cosmology and high-energy physics factor out nicely in this formula. Now this this quantity is defined, it has a name, and it's defined as J for some reason. And it depends on where I'm looking. So if I'm looking at the galactic center, there's one J, and if I'm looking at a particular dwarf, there's a different, probably smaller J, less dark matter, smaller J. The problem is that there's a large uncertainty on what this J is. So for our galaxy, the uncertainty is even two orders of magnitude. Just looking into the galactic center, and it comes mostly from the fact that we don't know the dark matter distribution very well near the center. For dwarves, it's more of, depends dwarf by dwarf, but the uncertainty is at least an order of magnitude these days. And why is this a problem? So just like direct detection that has the sigma m money plot, indirect detection also has sigma m money plots. So for indirect detection, it's often a sigma v on the y-axis, and the units are even more ridiculous. It's centimeter cubed per second. Now remember the magic number so this is, what's nice is that this is making contact with the WIMP miracle, if you like, the relic density story. This was the thing that determined the relic density. So there's some cross-section here that gives me the right relic density. Assuming that it's not this is a pretty much a flat function of dark matter mass. And this number is 3 times 10 to the minus 26 in these units. So this is a number that rolls off the tongue once you work in this field often. And limits look sort of like this. So this is 100 GV, 10 GV. So these plots, how do they? What are you assuming? You assume some final state, so BB bar. You calculate this using, say, Pythia. So you take BB bar events at even at a collider. It doesn't matter. You run Pythia. You see what's the distribution of gammas that you get in these collisions. You need to make sure you decay everything in Pythia. This is not a collider, so even neutrons need to decay, right? Everything needs to decay. You need to turn on the right switches in Pythia, or run some automated tool. And then you calculate this flux and compare to observation. The problem is that in addition to this thing that we know how to calculate, there is this thing. So the way I like to think of it is that actually where the theory goal is. So if you look at this, you'd think, well, around 100 GV, below 100 GV, thermal dark matter is ruled out if it's going to BB bar, right? Just by looking at some seemingly empty region of the sky where we know there's a dwarf galaxy. But however, because of this uncertainty, where this line actually is, to translate the limit to a physics goal, there's quite a bit of uncertainty. So the thermal relic band is actually a band here because of this sort of uncertainty. And this uncertainty can be improved if you measure the dwarf in question, if you measure the velocity distribution of stars, say, in this dwarf with precision. And that's something that people are trying to do. Let's see. So should I? So that is sort of. I have many more things to say about indirect detection. Should I give you a little bit of motivational spiel for collider stuff? And we may.
Can you say something about?
Yes.
Looking for anti-proton injection.
I can. So like positrons. So antimatter is less prevalent in the universe. Like positrons, you can also look for antiprotons. with antiprotons, the quantity that is often plotted is p bar, the p bar flux over p, just the ratio of proton to antiproton. And again, the same two experiments are relevant for this. There's Pamela and AMS. And as far as I can tell, they see no significant excess. And this has posed a big problem for there have been models that were proposed to explain the Pamela excess. And the problem is if you just assume that something goes to, I don't know, dark matter is annihilating to W's, okay, that will produce eventually some positrons, but it will also produce a lot of antiprotons. So naively, models that explained Pamela were in conflict with Pamela E plus E, the positron excess of Pamela were in conflict with Pamela, the antiproton observation. And so people invented cool ways to do it. Just say maybe it's leptophilic, maybe you only like leptons, or maybe dark matter is annihilating something that was very popular at the time. Dark matter is annihilating to two dark photons. If the dark photon has a mass of a GeV or below, it cannot decay to protons. So dark photons were very much studied in wake of the Pamela example. So yes, this is an important observation. Colliders. So yes, there's this. Now you don't need to pick your instrument. You know what the instrument is. It's the LHC. Well, actually, when I worked on this, it was the Tevatron. My first paper on this was Tevatron limits on dark matter. And so here, well, obviously, there's the well-known point that if I just assume an interaction like this between quarks and dark matter, in order to see anything, I'd better produce something in addition to the dark matter. So let's say it's a jet, or maybe it's more than one jet, maybe it's so this is either a monojet or a monophoton, or maybe there's two jets, so that's a monodijet, in that's how I like to call it, or mono multijet. You can do all sorts of mono, so there's monomania searches for dark matter, mono W, mono Z, mono top, everything. And with good reason, dark matter is missing energy, so we'd better look for things for missing energy signals. Now, very naively, I would like to make contact between these other searches and this collider search. So this blob, there are two possibilities for what this blob is. If the mediator that is mediating this blob is heavy, then perhaps I can integrate it out. Turns out that for some models I can, so that's good enough for me. Or it's maybe the mediator is light. Let's think about this first. So the and let's do just a monojet. So the cross section to emit one jet plus dark matter, well, that's proportional to alpha strong from this thing, and it will be proportional if the mediator is heavy. So really what I'm doing is I'm integrating out maybe a heavy Z prime, which has some couplings and a mass. So the effective operator that I get will be suppressed by 1 over lambda squared, right? So this will be proportional to 1 over lambda to the fourth times some other scale in the collision, some pt squared. Now notice that the cross-section in direct detection Well, it didn't have the alpha, but it also went like 1 over lambda to the fourth. So you may ask whether I can integrate out whether this mediator is heavy enough to be integrated out for LHC energies, but so long as the mass of this guy is above, say, the MeV range, certainly I can integrate it out in direct detection. So here, the two can compete, right? They're sort of probing the same quantity. So if I make this assumption, let's see, did I remove? I removed my money plot. Very unwise of me. This is the sigma from direct detection. This is the mass of the dark matter. Colliders can show up on this plot, at least in this simplified model. The simplified is a non-renormalizable effective field theory, but I can still call it a simplified model. And it turns out that these limits sort of look like this for the spin independent case. For the spin-dependent case, the collider won't change, and this gets a 10 to the 4 hit. So there, the competition is actually tighter, if I'm on this side of the column. And it's very important to remember this, that this is model-dependent. Great. So here it's mu squared, just for completeness. Great, so what happens on this? If I take the mediator to be light, then it's a very light Z prime. There's a Q squared minus M squared, M Z prime squared. That is this propagator. But if the mediator is sufficiently light, I can ignore it. And so now the only scale in the problem, the cross-section for one jet, again, will go like the same alpha s, but instead of having this this cutoff in it, the cutoff is no longer, the mass of the mediator is no longer part of the story. It's just some scale that has to do with the collision. So let me just write it as 1 over pt squared. Right, so now you see the collider and direct detection are not really probing the same quantity. In fact, I can take, so this cutoff here, oh, I failed to define it. The cutoff is the mass over the coupling, right? If this is a coupling G, this is the mass of the Z prime. I can take both of these to be small together, keeping lambda fixed, keeping direct detection fixed. But, oh, here I forgot the most important thing. There's the coupling of the Z prime, right? To the fourth power, actually. So if I take both of these to be small together, this thing loses, okay? So I can continuously go from this limit, where the mediator is very heavy, and colliders compete in interesting ways. They do well for light-dark matter, because they don't have energy thresholds to deal with, to this limit, where the collider completely craps out. So I would say if you're working in this business, never just work in one of these cases. Always extrapolate. Be also unkind to yourself, and always extrapolate to the limit in which the collider is doing a crappy job, because it is certainly a possibility. Now, when you extrapolate between the two, what happens? So I told you what happens in one extreme case. I told you what happens in a different extreme case, when the mediator is a very light or very heavy. So this is the mass of the mediator. So I'm now taking this full trip from very heavy mediator to very light mediator, and strong coupling for the mediator to weak coupling of the mediator. And I'm going to plot the limit that you get from one of these searches, a monojet search. Now we know, I told you, you'll get some limit that is actually pretty good on this scale. So this is what appears in direct detection for very high mass. So this is sort of the EFT answer. And it meets the Z prime answer for very high masses. At low mediator masses, in the limit this coupling goes to zero, you also get a crappy limit. Now, it turns out that in the middle, what happens is that, so now I've kept the dark matter mass fixed in this story. I can produce just the Z prime on shell and a jet. And the Z prime can now decay to dark matter. So because this is now two-body production, this is actually a higher cross-section. So you gain some in your limit. And then at some point, since I kept the dark matter fixed, dark matter mass, so this is twice the mass of dark matter, I cannot do this anymore. And then the limit goes to crap. So for me, there has been this sort of debate in the community whether this EFT limit is appropriate to take or not. I think the first talk this evening is about that. To me, it's always a useful thing. So I'm not sure what this last get. In the coffee break, whoever is giving this talk, come talk to me and tell me what you mean by last gasp. But for me, this is always an interesting number to compute, because after all, what we want to get out of the LHC is the fact that you did not find an excess in monojet. What does that say about dark matter? So once we discover dark matter, then we should definitely do everything. And I am advocating that we should do not just this, but also that, but once I've made this plot, I know that this is how it behaves, so the only open question is, how high is this going to get? There are some models where it's not up and down, but like this, these are sort of T-channel mediators. Questions, complaints? Okay. What else did I have to say? There are other, now, this is one set of very simple models that you can think of. There are others that you can make a completely different assumption and make a very tight connection between the LHC. Maybe my favorite example is just this very simple hypothesis that dark matter interacts through a Higgs. So again, if you're doing, Tillman drew this diagram, but let's say it's BB bar. Chi chi bar to TT bar, that is a dark matter annihilation in some SUSY models, or I can just think of some Higgs portal model where this is how we talk to dark matter. So now I can turn this on its side, turn this into standard model particles, I can get direct detection from that. I told you where that lives, but now I can also produce, if this is the Higgs, I can also produce the Higgs at the LHC along with something else and let the Higgs decay into dark matter. And so the only thing I don't know in this story, in addition to the mass of dark matter, is the coupling of the dark matter to the Higgs. So once you find the Higgs and have a limit on invisible branching fractions, you can immediately place a bound on direct detection. And that limit is very interesting. So again, this is the Lux slash Panda X. I call it Lux till I see Panda X, I won't believe it. Maybe you're all pulling my leg. And again, like all these plots, this is model dependent. What is the model dependent statement I'm making now? I'm assuming dark matter interacts through a Higgs. Okay? Having done that, I get a model independent, no, I'm kidding. I get a bound where this mass is m Higgs over 2, which is a number we know. And it is a very powerful bound, right? So this is LHC, invisible Higgs, this is Lux, and they're very nice and complementary. And how is this bound? Just by turning on the LHC and finding just one little particle and you immediately do as well as Lux. The reason is that the Higgs, famously, is very narrow. The coupling of the Higgs to the B is very small. And so it's very easy for dark matter, if it couples to the Higgs at all, to compete with BB bar and to get a sizable invisible branching fraction. I'm impolitely out of time. The neutrino floor was, you may have stepped out of the room. The neutrino floor is, compared to this, I believe it is close. I believe it is close. Okay, we can check. They're not touching yet. I'm pretty sure they're not touching. Is it exciting? You've made progress. Science has progressed. What would have been really exciting if there was a signal of invisible Higgs decay, and then we would be really, that would be really exciting. Thanks. Good point. So in all three of these detection methods, there's a lot to do. Another example I should advertise. Once you think about dark matter production at the LHC, again, not necessarily within the SUSY framework, but more broadly, so today you heard about co-annihilation. All of your organizers and a few other people who are from Mainz have written an extensive and thorough study of what happens with co-annihilation at the LHC once you make some simple assumptions. Okay, let's assume that you're co-annihilating with a particle that is colored. It's a triplet, or maybe it's an octet. And now you can, so now co-annihilation gives you the added benefit that you can be charged or colored, and part of the dark plane, important part in dark matter, but then you can get produced at the LHC, not in these sort of crappy ways of EFTs, but really produced at the LHC. But that leads to some cascade or something interesting that happens, and you can get new signals. So the co-annihilation codex, this is not, I'm not making this up, this is the title of the paper, so they made it up. So while organizing the school, they also meticulously went through many, many possibilities of co-annihilation, and it's upon you to show what they, how they screwed up and missed some interesting possibilities, right? So that's I should point that interesting work out. I think we should continue over coffee. Questions as well. Yeah. Yeah. More questions. Yes.
With cold dark matter, they're not relativistic.
Yes.
Collider, they are, right?
Right. So, true. So, dark matter.
In this?
So yes, they are relativistic in the collider. But when we say cold dark matter, we mean that the particles that make up the dark matter in the cosmos is cold. But any particle, if I produce it in a new and different way, can be relativistic, right? And the dark matter that is being produced at the LHC is not contributing to the global budget of dark matter in a significant way, so everything's fine. But the fact that dark matter is being produced relativistic means that collider limits will be complementary to things like direct detection in important ways. So for example, I've sung the praise of inelastic dark matter as something that drastically changes the phenomenology of direct detection, right? Because you add a mass splitting of a huge mass splitting of 150 kV between two dark matter states, and direct detection phenomenology gets completely transformed. I didn't even tell you everything there was to tell you about that. Now the collider 150 kV doesn't care at all, right? You can just produce chi and chi prime instead of chi and chi. So there are interesting ways in which the collider, because they're producing dark matter in a completely different kinematic regime, is complementary. And that's cool. On the other hand, again, the collider, once you make the mediator light and very weakly coupled, the collider fails miserably, but direct detection succeeds. So it's showing the where these are complementary is good. Yes. More questions. Yes.
For the inelastic dark matter.
Yes.
I guess that the chi prime will decay at all. It always.
Ah yes yes. Yes, it always decays inside the detector. There are a few twists to that. So for realistic models of inelastic dark matter, they were always decaying outside the detector. There are all sorts of caveats to this. Not caveats, but twists. So people have written models where chi prime is so long-lived that actually what's giving you a direct detection signal, say in Dhamma, is chi prime decaying down to chi. So not decaying down, but scattering down to chi. So that's exothermic instead of inelastic, exothermic. So people wrote that. Actually, I wrote that. Another interesting possibility, which I didn't write, though some people have confused and thought that I did, something called luminous dark matter. So I'm just going through some of the models in my list. So here you have, again, an inelastic splitting. What happens is somewhere in the Earth, chi scatters up to chi prime, and then somewhere else in the Earth, which happens to be inside my detector, it decays back down with emitting a 3 kV photon. That was a beautiful explanation of Dhamma. Why? Because Dhamma at the time was the biggest detector. So if this is the story for dark matter, Dhamma, you just need a big volume and instrument it without any target. It's actually coming from decays. But that was quickly killed by Xenon, which was another detector that is very large and superseded Dhamma in size. So the if you take this idea of just a splitting and start playing, scattering up, scattering down, decaying, all sorts of interesting phenomenology shows up. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Like obviously, you know, if this thing has some structure, then also the shape of the signal will change. Like if you were able to.
Sure.
How big they
are. Sure. So there are form factors that could come. So form factor dark matter. Did I write that one down? Form factors can come from the dark matter side of the collision. There are form factors that I didn't tell you about at all. They're a whole story of itself, but that's standard model physics. That for the nuclear side. But yes, so adding compositeness can change the story, can add velocity dependence. Yeah. Coffee or more questions? Yes. No, more questions.
Can you say two words about black holes as a dark matter?
Black holes. Two words about black holes. They are so again. So we some of us have had a little bit of discussion. There are limits on black holes as dark matter. I think one interesting open question is: can 30 solar mass black holes be dark matter? The ones that we now know exist following LIGO. The current one analysis says, which predates LIGO, says that CMB data rules that out by 4 orders of magnitude, and some people are currently questioning that. So I think it's an interesting open question that so some paper will some more papers will emerge out of Hopkins and maybe some other places as to whether that is a possibility. Dark matter in general, black hole dark matter, there is a window that is still open. I think you knew the number. It's measured in grams.
Yeah, something between 10 to the 17th and 18 grams.
Yes. Okay, so 10 to the 17 to 8 to 10 to the 17 to 18 grams. It's I find it amazing that you measure dark matter in grams, the same unit used for dope. yeah, people pick funny units. Limits come mostly from there are some limits from CMB, we said, macho searches, so looking for compact halo objects and micro lensing. Some people have pointed out that if dark matter is made of black holes in a certain mass range, they would cause white dwarfs to, they would deposit heat in an extended region in a white dwarf and cause it to go supernova. So there are some limits. I'm personally less familiar with them.